morning, gang. It's Thursday, the 6th of April, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom talk. Oh, my God. Shock, horror. It's all over the newspapers, isn't it? It's all over the newspapers. And he's sitting there. He's sitting over there on his calendar. And he's sitting directly behind me there. Yes, boys and girls, as you've only just found out, the world's best-kept secret, Barry Manilow, has now told us all that he's gay. The fact that he got married a year ago or so, is neither here nor there. Barry Manilow has now come out as being gay. He goes, oh, I can hear the disappointment in women screaming all over the world, boys and girls. Women are screaming all over the world. I didn't know. Oh, I didn't know Barry Manilow was gay. Really? Couldn't you tell? Weren't there a couple of little bits and pieces that might have given it away? I have to say, I wasn't sure. All those years, I wasn't sure. The very first concert of Barry's I went to, 2011, I think, at the O2 with the wonderful Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. And my biggest regret of that one, it was the first concert. Actually, it was only the second concert I'd ever been to of all concerts. The only other one being Wham, which I went to in the 80s. I think I was the only fella there. They were all screaming girls. Well, I was screaming as well, actually. That was the only other concert. So the first Barry Manilow concert I went to was in 2011 at the O2. And I didn't know how to book seats or anything like that. And I kind of just thought, oh, right, well, let's have a seat and a da-da-da-da, typed in, what seat do you want? And I don't know. Best seat available. And we were up there. Barry Manilow was a small ant on the stage, surrounded by even smaller ants behind him, playing instruments. Ooh, ooh, boom, 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 boom. Ding, 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 ding. And his wonderful dancers. I don't know his name, actually. Who's the black dance? Not dancers, backing singers. Who's the black singer with the dreadlocks? He's really good. Such a big personality. I think the world of him, actually. I do. And the only regret there is the fact that I was so far away, and probably out of all the concerts that I've been, I would really have wanted to be right at the front and seeing all the instruments played with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra and all that. But still a good show. And I thought, oh, I wonder if he is gay. Okay? It was the second show that gave it away for me. And do you know what it was that gave it away? It was the twirls. No one does twirls unless they're gay. I'm sure they don't. It was the twirling. He came on and the song was It's a Miracle. He came on, you know, it's a miracle, because he does this special version of It's a Miracle for his live shows, which is fantastic. And he comes on and suddenly he twirled. And that's when I twigged. No one does twirls. I've made notes. Look at this. Jay-Z. Jay-Z. Have you ever seen Jay-Z do a twirl? Kanye West. Have you seen Kanye West do a twirl? No. Frank Sinatra? No twirls. Dean Martin? Nope. Bon Jovi. When they're on that stage in their tight black leather trousers, do they do twirls? No twirls. Luther Vandross? No twirls. Take that. Hang on a minute. Take that. Doesn't Robbie Williams twirl sometimes in Take That shows? I think Take That might do twirls. I don't think any of them are gay, unless they're in a closet. Like Barry was for years and years and years. Nobody knew. Shock, horror. Oh my God, Barry's gay. I can't believe it. Really? Even Beyonce doesn't do a twirl. And she's not even a bloke. It's the twirls that gave it away for me. Do we have one or two Barry Manilow fans watching the show today, I wonder? What is it that told you that Barry Manilow was gay? Or maybe it was the announcement. Maybe you really didn't know. Not everyone's got like a gaydar where you can tell if people are gay or not. It's true. I mean, sometimes I look at certain politicians. Ken Livingstone, for example. He looks a bit sus, doesn't he? I think it does. Look, we've got a call coming in already. And we haven't even opened the phone lines yet. Good evening. Oh, have I picked you up? Yeah, there you go. Good morning, Elaine. How are you?
Good morning, Chris. You were expecting my phone call, weren't you?
I was expecting your phone call, you lovely creature. How's your radio show going, Elaine?
Oh, the radio show's going just well. Just great, thanks.
Excellent.
I don't have as much of a following as you do, but it's doing well.
You probably do. You probably got more than me because FM radio, you haven't got a little thing in front of you telling you how many people are listening. It's probably thousands.
Oh, I don't know. I have no way to measure my listens.
Listenership. Thousands and thousands on both sides of the border. I'm sure there are.
Absolutely. Oh, thank you for that vote of confidence.
Go on, Elaine.
Let me tell you, Chris. These are the times when being a Barry Manilow fan is not only about concerts and fun and music. It's also a very big responsibility because people perceive you as like sort of a spokesman, which you're not. So any item of news that happens with Barry, people come up to you and they say, did you hear this? And what about this? And what do you think about this? And all of a sudden, you feel like one of the family. You know what I mean?
Like
you become like a sort of PR person. Anyway, the news that broke yesterday, first of all, you know, I love Barry dearly, as you know. Okay, I've been a fan for over 40 years. Okay, anyone who has been a fan for that long knew, okay, or at least suspected that this is what's happening. And in 2014, Suzanne Somers herself, okay, attended the wedding, and she said that he was married to Gary Keefe. Does that mean?
Was it 3 years ago now? Gosh, I thought
it was 3 years
year.
Ago. It was April 2014.
Blimey,
they got married.
Yep.
Suzanne Somers was the best man, okay? And she spoke with such love and respect about her friendship with Barry, and they've been friends forever, okay?
Yes, Suzanne, please.
So why the news didn't break 3 years ago, I have no idea. I don't know his considerations. He had his own considerations. Fine, I respect that, okay? But let me tell you something. Yesterday, I truly believe that a huge weight was lifted off millions of shoulders, not just his, okay? Because it was a minefield that we couldn't really talk about for years, okay? He is, as you know, an extremely private person, and we all respected his privacy all these years. The subject of his private life was totally taboo. We couldn't touch it, and, you know, I respect that, okay? The only thing he owes us, in quotation marks, is concerts and albums and songs, fine. I don't want to know what goes on in his living room in Palm Springs. I have no right to know that. And he himself said, you can't come into my life unless I invite you in. And I respect that, okay? But yesterday, when the whole thing exploded, I felt a huge boulder coming off of my shoulders because we could honestly and openly be happy for him and Gary. And we are. We are so ecstatic. We can't even begin to explain to you how happy that we are. Because contrary to popular belief, not all the female fans want to jump his bones. Okay? I mean, we can lust after him in concerts. We can be excited when he does those hips-shaking moves, as my UK friends will tell you. But honestly, I mean, do we really think that any one of us had a chance with him? I mean, come on.
Oh, some of them do. Some of the other Manilow girls, they tell me you get people in the audience who are shouting back at him sometimes like they're trying to have a conversation. Yeah, they say they've told me that, the girls. Oh.
Well, that's part of the routine.
I'd lost you then.
Part of the shtick.
Eh?
That's part of the shtick, what's called in Yiddish. That's part of the routine. Okay, that we all lust after him, and we all sigh, and we all scream, and we all, that's part of the deal, okay? Yeah. But seriously, I mean, do any of us really think that we had a chance with him? No, okay? So, of course, you know, and if you've seen the pictures on the internet, and I'm sure you've seen the pictures on the internet, look at his face. I cannot remember the last time I have seen such a 1,000-kilowatt smile on that person's face.
Yeah.
Okay? You can see in his eyes and you can see on his face the relief and the happiness. And I have to tell you, I have no idea how he could have ever thought that we would change our devotion or change, you know, like stop being fans because of his sexual orientation, which has absolutely nothing to do with the music that he does. Okay? I mean, I wrote him on his Facebook page and I said, you know, I'm going through, I have breast cancer. Right. And I'm going through treatment and I'm going for an operation. And he has been with me with every crisis of my life, including this one. And did he really think that I'll stop listening to him because of who he sleeps with? I mean, give me a break. I can't understand that way of thinking. Let me tell you something. I've been with him since age 15, okay? I've known, like, since when he wrote his autobiography in 78, okay? He first met Gary in 1978 after a huge financial crisis that he was in that Gary helped bring him out of, okay? You know what? I fell in love with Gary in 78. So no wonder that he fell in love with Gary in 78, you know?
Yeah.
The man saved his life, literally, you know, brought him up from ruins. And I have no idea I have no doubt that he developed feelings for him, which is totally legitimate. And through the years, I've been working very closely together. And you know something? I actually had tears in my eyes looking at his face, okay, on TV. In the pictures, he is the happiest I have ever seen him in all my 42 years of being a fan. And just for that reason, I'm glad that the news came out. And I'm so sorry that it took him this long. He could have come out in 2014 after the wedding. I don't know why he did it.
One of the other things that he was saying there is that he didn't want to disappoint people. Now. I relate to that. I never told my father. I never told my father about myself because I thought he would be disappointed. He might have felt that he had failed in some way. Now, a lot of people are not like that. They feel, well, this is how I am. I'm going to announce it into the world. Take it or leave it. Some of us, perhaps it's a bit of an old school thing here, whereas I would never have told my dad. You know, I wouldn't just, you know, I think he would have been very disappointed and not known what to do. And I think there might be a little bit of that in there, whereas it replaced my dad with his fans. Do you see what I mean?
Well, I'll tell you something. It's all about love and respect. It's not quite the same thing because family is one thing and fans are another thing. The love that we have for Barry is different than the love that your father has for you, okay? So, obviously. And the worst thing that a fan could do is just turn off the radio whenever his music comes on. However, your father could, you know, the relationship between you and your father could have worsened.
Yes.
God forbid. So your fear with your father is a more legitimate fear than Barry's fear for his fans, because what's the worst thing a fan could do? Stop buying an album.
Stop buying the albums, yeah. Turn the radio off.
He has millions of fans, okay? So if like 20 or something like that, stop. If this causes Barry to lose fans, they were not fans in the first place.
Yes, I totally agree with you. And you know what? In this day and age, it doesn't make any difference. Certainly to the youngsters, it makes no difference at all what you are. None at all. I go, when I go and visit my sister and her family, sometimes my nephew Jimmy, he was 20 at the weekend. But when I go up there at Christmas time, I have to go in. I go into a pub to collect him, usually when he's really drunk, and all his mates in there, and they watch this show. Not all the time. Now and again, they dip in and out of the show. And honestly, the response I get up there is something else, you know. And there's no mention to what you are. I don't think the youngsters they don't even talk about it anymore. He's gay, yep, okay. She's straight, all right, okay. It doesn't make any difference to them. It's just a normal thing. And I think we've come such a long way since the 70s. I think in the 70s it was very different. And I'm sure...
I'll tell you, Elton John first came out as bisexual in 1976.
Sorry, what was that, darling?
I said Elton John.
Yes.
First declared his bisexuality in 1976.
Yes, yes.
Nothing happened. The world didn't stop turning. Mm,
yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
The stock market didn't crash. Nothing happened, okay? But Elton John's fan base is not Barry Manilow's fan base. So there's I admit it, you know, Barry Manilow's fan base is mostly women. What can you do? mind you, what can you do?
But lately,
I have to tell you that lately, more and more men have been coming to like Barry Manilow's music, especially after he released 15 Minutes.
Yeah.
That, I think, was a big turning point in his career, which brought him to a younger audience and a male audience because of that album, which was more guitar-driven than piano-driven, and it appealed to a wider spectrum of fans than his usual piano ballad love songs. So these days you have more and more men who are becoming Barry Manilow fans. And you've seen them in concerts also.
I think a lot of them are secret Manilow listeners. And what we need now is for the men to come out. They need to come out as Barry fans, because it's all about the music. It's actually all about the personality as well. He's got a fantastic personality. It's all about the music and the personality, isn't it?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you ever so much for calling.
Unique. He's so unique in that, you know, I really don't want to take up your whole show, but I don't have to tell you what Barry Manilow is, okay? I mean, you know,
I have the pictures on the wall as well.
And
Elaine.
I say again, the last thing I have to say is this. First of all, I'm ecstatic for them, for Barry and Gary. I'm so happy for them, and so are all of us. And the next thing is, if anyone stops being a Manilow fan because of this, they were not fans in the first place.
Just say goodbye to them.
Bye bye.
Just say goodbye to them. That's what I say.
Yes.
All right, Elaine, darling. Thank you very much for calling in.
Thank you very much, Chris.
And good luck with your show again. All right. Cheerio, my love.
Bye bye.
The lovely Elaine calling in from Israel. There was some points there. So there we are, really. You know, it's all about the twirls. It's all about... I think I should do a twirl, actually. If I stand up, you lose my head, don't you? I haven't quite got around to tilting cameras yet. Not got around to tilting cameras. I'll do a twirl like that. There we are. That's sort of half a twirl, isn't it? Any more comments on that? You can call in if you want to. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number, OK? 020-8144-3477. There's a Skype name as well. If you want to call in on a Skype, that's OK. Skype username is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. Let's say hello to some people who are with us this morning. James Clark, good morning. Anne Taplin, this news is so old. It's so old. Oh, it is, James. It is, James. Kay, good morning to Kay, who enjoys the intense build-up. That's every day, Kay. You can see that intense build-up, okay? Wendy says, we've known for at least 30 years that Barry's gay. Let me go up there. Callum Dove, good morning, Callum, who says, I've only been to one concert. What have you been to see, Callum? What concert have you been to see to? Good morning to Darren Lee Wicks, who says, oh no, all those old dears. What do you mean old dears? What do you mean old dears? Beg your pardon, Darren. Dear me, they are already in shock years ago with Liberace. They must be very nervous about Cliff. No, not nervous about Cliff. Cliff, people need to come out before they're told. That's it. Ben Parker says, does that mean in Copacabana he was singing about Mrs. Lasagna? Isn't that something you eat? Lasagna? And he renames his big hit Andy. Oh, Andy, well, you came and you gave without shaking. Oh, yes, that's the one. Kay says, what gave him away about Barry being gay was the tight trousers. Oh, do you know what, Kay? All my trousers are tight now. even the ones that are two sizes too big. Oh, dear, just getting fatter and fatter. I gave up all these things for Lent, you know. No weight lost. What is all that about? Bread, crisps, cakes, chocolate. Gave it all up. Haven't lost any weight. Don't understand it. Wendy says, I've seen Take That live. Lots of twirls and that. Yes, you see, I knew it. Take That, do twirls. Do you do twirls, Wendy? I hope you do, dear. Robbie swings both ways. No, he's married, Ben. Ben is married. What proof have you got, dear? You can't make outrageous conclusions like that, dear, on this programme. James says, have you been to Tesco's right by the tills at the end of the aisle with the sweets? Lots of twirls. I'm not keen on those. I like the giant... I used to like the giant Cadbury's chocolate buttons. I'm a Galaxy man now. Galaxy, yes. Sweet and silky Galaxy. Good morning to Gustav, who with us a little late this morning, aren't you, Gustav? Let's have a look. Let's just go up there. Good morning to Ray Reynolds. Another lovely day. And Sunday's going to be 75 degrees on Sunday, you know. 75 degrees on Sunday. It's going to be. Yes. Don't ask me what centigrade is. We don't do foreign currency on this programme. Good morning, Adam the Plumber.
Good morning, Chris Friend. How are you?
All right. Thank you very much.
Do you know, I thought I was watching an archive show there for a minute. Finding out that Barry was gay. I thought we covered that 1 year ago.
You thought what? A what show?
We covered that 1 year ago.
Did you thought I was watching a what?
I said we thought we covered that 1 year ago.
No, you started off, gay. You said I thought I was watching a something show.
Archive.
An archive show. Okay, lovey. No, dear, no. This is all new news to us. We didn't even know.
I'm in shock. I might have to go for counselling.
Someone who will remain nameless mentioned to me that isn't it funny that all this has come out just as a new album is about to release?
Mm-hmm.
You didn't think creating a little bit of interest, you know, a bit of an extra interest.
Yes, indeed, yes.
Do you see what I mean? You're on a blasted iPhone 7 hands-free, aren't you now?
Mm-hmm.
Is that it, then?
Oh. No, still there, Chris. Sorry, I'm stuck in the jam at the moment. I'm just trying to pull over so I can take you off of hands-free.
Oh, haven't you got your... you haven't got a traffic app, have you?
I have downloaded Waze, is it?
Waze, yes.
I'm trying that out now. How are you getting on with your ways?
Okay. Although last night, there seemed to be a bit of a problem last night. So I went onto my TomTom, but the traffic thing wasn't working. Now it has done, I think I've had it 3 or 4 years now. And in that time, it's done that a couple of times, and it usually happens for an hour or so, but then it starts working. Well, last night it wasn't working when I went to work, on the way back, or this morning. So I rung up TomTom, their customer advice, and I got to say that I've had to ring them a couple of times. They're very, very good. They answer very quickly, within 10 seconds. They answer the phone, ask you the problem, then they look on their computer, you give them your email address, they look on your computer, do some stuff, and then they're able to tell you what's wrong. And they told me that they've had this problem for a couple of days. There's some other people reporting it, and they're working on it. Until they get it working, they upgrade me to their new app and give me 3 years' worth of traffic. I think they're trying to shift everyone over to their new app because the old one is going to be stopped updating in September.
Yep,
and
okay.
I downloaded that just before I started the show, actually. And all is hunky-dory. Really good customer service with TomTom. Very, very good indeed. Yeah.
That is good. That is good, yeah. I'm just phoning in to give you a Slimming World report while I've got you on the phone.
You're giving me a what?
A Slimming World report.
Oh, yes. How's the weight loss going?
Right. Well, yesterday I completely smashed it. I got my 2 stone award.
You've now lost... Two stone in how many weeks? 12 weeks. Wow.
12 weeks.
Wow.
I've also got what they call my Club 10 award, which is I've lost 10% of my body weight in 10 weeks.
Do you know, I don't know what to say to you. That is just fantastic news.
Fantastic news.
I tell you what, have you seen how thin Barry Manilow is? How can you get that thin, dear? I wonder if he eats much. I wonder what he eats. We need to go on the Barry Manilow diet. That's what we need to do, Lovie. I
would imagine the Barry Manilow diet is probably the amount of effort and energy that he puts into every one of his shows.
I think we're coming back to the twirls here. The twirls. If we twirl a little bit more randomly when we're out, I think the weight will just fall off, to be honest, Lovie.
Yeah, it could do. Just twirl in the street, you know, just go for a twirl.
I think we should start
a new thing. Instead of twerking, we should be twirling.
Twirling.
we could have 12 videos on the internet.
12 video. Do we need to do 12 videos?
Yes.
I think we should start doing 12s at the karaoke nights.
actually, Chris, why don't you do, seeing as you're such an international star, And known worldwide.
Understand.
And you know how a lot of international stars release videos.
Yes.
You could release a Chris Redden twirling video.
A twirling video where we could lose weight.
Oh dear,
you are funny, dear.
I think that would work wrong. Well, you know, you get the Jane Fonda workout and the what was the lady in the green?
The Green Goddess, Breakfast TV time.
And now you can have the Chris Redden twirl out.
The Chris Redden twirl out.
20 minutes of your day just to twirl away.
I think I'm going to have to do something like this. Me and Ronnie will do something like that together. Actually,
mind you, you have done exercise videos in the past. You have done exercise videos in the past.
I have, yes. I think there's been a couple
on previous shows.
I can't remember. Could you find those for us and just send us a couple of links and let's have a look at them?
Yes, I will. They're on your. I think they're on Lip Sync, so I'll have a look on there.
Okay, maybe we can twirl to Barry Manilow's songs. It's got to be "It's a Miracle." That's the one I'll have to use.
Yeah, that's
if
true.
If I can find
that's
an
true.
Instrumental. I have got an instrumental version of that.
You've got your maracas as well, so you could do the Kaka Kabbalah and your upper. You've got your maracas, so get your maracas out.
One of them's broken.
Oh, so you have a marac.
I'm down to three now. No, I had four. I've only got three.
Oh, okay.
No, hang on a minute. Have I got three or two? I've only got two left now, I think. Oh, no, or three. Mm-hmm. I've either got three or two left. One went missing when someone started mucking around. Now, I hate that. People come up and borrow your instruments, and they start getting lost. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying someone's nicked one, but where's that gone? You know how you put things down? It's a bit like, do you remember being at home with your mum? Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And you're playing with your toys, and you go and you come back, where's my toys? Oh, I've put them away. Yeah, but where? Where have you put them away? And you can't find that toy again. And it's disappeared for all eternity. Why do mums put toys away?
Yes, I had a similar thing when I was a child, actually. My mum... I had this old clunked out valve radio that I used to love.
Oh, wow, wonderful. Yeah.
And it was an old valve radio, and it was literally falling to pieces.
A little bit like yourself, Adam.
A bit like myself, yeah. A bit dropping off all over the place. And it's lucky we're such good friends, isn't it, dear?
Go on.
Anyway, so I had this lovely old radio, but there was bits of wiring in it. And obviously, mum thought it was a bit too dangerous for me. So I came home from school one day and I went to go and grab my radio. I said, "Where's the radio?" She said, "I tidied it away." I said, "But where?" She said, "You have to try and find it." And, you know, 35 years on, I'm still looking for it.
Thank you for calling in, young Adam. Very
fantastic.
Chris. Adam, what is your... Just before you go...
Yeah. Yeah, go on.
So, how much more weight do you want to lose?
Right, I want to get down to 12 stone, Chris.
So what are you
12
now?
Or 13 stone. So I'm currently now at 17 stone 6. My original weight when I started was 19 stone 7. Yeah, 19 stone 7. I'm now 19 stone 6 and a half. So I smashed the two stone wall yesterday by a pound and a half.
I didn't know you were 19 stone, mate.
Yeah, 19 stone 7 I was. That was in... I started, obviously, 3 months ago. So was that January the 17th, something like that, I think it was.
Have you noticed anything happening to your body, apart from the weight
loss?
Yes,
I have, yeah.
Go on.
as you know, Chris, but the viewers probably won't, I've got arthritis in both my knees. I now can run upstairs without any pain whatsoever.
Wow.
So that really helps. And also, obviously, I've had to go out and buy a new wardrobe. When I started this journey, I was bridging on a 44-inch waist.
Yes.
I was just bridging on a 44-inch waist and now down to a 38.
That is a real achievement, Adam. I'm going to have to open that book. I'm going to have to open that book that you gave me.
Open that book and take a look.
Hasn't been opened yet, I'm afraid.
No. Well, get opening it and start looking at it, because you will be... Because a lot of people think, oh, it's a diet. Oh, I'm going to have to give up this, you know, give up that. Not with Slimming World. There's nothing you can't eat on Slimming World. You've just got to monitor what you eat and watch what you eat.
I often think, you know, when I put my gym on a platter, I think, my God, that looks big. Do you know what I mean? Mm. But it's, I'll open what to me looks like an individual pie from Marks and Spencer's. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a packet of vegetables. Those vegetables, even the vegetables, I mean, when I look at them, I think surely that's for two people. But then in my head, I think, well, they're only vegetables, so that's okay. I don't know.
Well, you see, the thing is with vegetables are a free food, and they're also what is known as a speed food. They actually help you lose weight. The more you fill your plate up with vegetables, the less room there is for thin foods, and those vegetables actually help you burn and actually the speed food that you need. Whereas you take your Marks and Spencer's vegetable pie, for instance, that has probably got more thins for the day than any other foods put together. Because, unfortunately, because it's manufactured, you know, shop manufactured, they stuff it full of sugars and goodness of what to make it taste really nice. Yes, you think, that was really lovely, that pie. You know, and it's absolutely full of stuff. I don't know if I can... What pie is it that you like?
It's Marks and Spencer's... mushroom and onion. Onion and mushroom, right. Mushroom and onion pie. It's got potato on the top.
All right, okay, yeah. Mushroom and onion, okay.
Roast onion
and mushroom. Well, what I'll do, Chris, I won't clog up the line now, but if you keep an eye out on the messages, and I'll look up what Marks and Spencer's pie is. So it's Marks and Spencer's, what flavour again, sorry?
Mushroom and onion pie. It's not like mushroom a pastry thing. It's mushrooms and onions in a gravy with potato on the top.
Okay, mushroom and onion.
And it's like
I shall have a look and put the comment on the post down below.
Okay, thank you very much, Adam. Have a lovely day,
cheers,
sir.
Chris. And you. Bye-bye.
Cheerio. Bye-bye. Adam the plumber calling in there, boys and girls. An excellent call, as always, from Adam. It's always a pleasure to hear from him, isn't it? Let's do some more of your messages, and then we've got a couple of stories and that to read out to you this morning. Morning to Craig Wright. Good morning, Craig. Darren says, Elaine is lovely. She is a lovely lady, Elaine. And she's got her own radio show now in Israel, which she has been doing for a little while now. Carl Rex Morrison is with us. Good morning, Carl. Mark Coburn is there. Hello, Mark. Darren says, I think that your twirling point lost a little weight with Luther Vandross. Maybe he twirled in private. Do you think so? We'll have to do a twirling video. Gustav says, do you think you may have retained a colossal amount of weight due to the custard creams? Just ask and love it. Well, I only had the one packet over 2 days. You know, only one packet custard creams. I think Angel Delight has become my latest craze, hasn't it? However, I've got to tell you, I don't have any more in the cupboard. So maybe I won't buy any more Angel Delight. No more Angel Delight for Chris, I'm afraid. God, all the good things are disappearing, aren't they? All right, let's do a couple of stories. Good morning to James Clark, who's just joined us this morning. Now, look at this. Where is it now? I don't know if you saw this. I just saw this on the news just before I came up this morning. Breaking news. Father who took his daughter on a long-term holiday and refuses to pay a £60 fine, loses his epic 2-year Supreme Court legal battle. Now, I saw this on the news this morning. And this bloke, when did this happen? It was some time ago now. Here we go. Yes, here we are. The father of three took his seven-year-old child on a holiday to an American villa and Disney World in April 2015, believing it was better for her development than staying at school, which she had an exemplary attendance record. So she wasn't one of those people that was ill or, you know, kept taking time off and pretended to be ill and that sort of thing. but nevertheless, he did take her child out of school time to go on holiday. And the judge, I think the magistrates went against him. This is like the lower level. So he then appealed against that to go, I think, to a Supreme Court or something like that. And they have sided with the magistrates and say, well, you know, you can't just take your children out of school whenever you want and take them on holiday. What if everyone did that? And I think, to be honest, I think they're quite right. I think they're quite right. OK, if you're ill or sick, then fair enough. But to just take your children out of school just because you want to go on holiday, I think is a bit much, really. It also disrupts, doesn't it? Disrupt the rest of the class. You know, if your children have missed 2 weeks of schooling and everyone else has done that work, when they come back, they have to catch up. Doesn't that slow everyone else down? So actually, I think the court is right. You can't just take your children out of school, you know, whenever you feel like it, to go on holiday or go and visit Nan or something like that. That's not right. School is 9 till 3 or whatever it is in the morning. That's the time you have to be there. Like a job. Like a job. There's so many people now, in particular, badly paid bar staff. Now, we all know, it's not in this particular country, not everywhere in the world, but in this country, bar staff are badly paid. Some of them are not even paid the minimum wage. I could name you a list of places that are not paying bar staff the minimum wage. Cash in hand jobs. Not paying tax. I could tell you some of those places, but I won't. Okay? But bar staff in particular, they you know, I'm not well today, I'm not coming in at the last minute. Or they just don't show up. Now, whether that's because the money is so bad, I don't know. But bar staff are particularly bad in that. Not everyone. There's some damn good bar staff in London. Really very good bar staff, badly treated. There are also some good bar staff who are well treated, you know, and looked after and that. But bar staff in particular are people that they just ring up on the off chance. You know, they're kind of casual labour anyway. You know, they booked. There's no like 9 to 5 or anything like that. But certainly the casual bar staff just seem to turn up when they feel like it or whatever. Well, same at school. You've got to be at the school at that time. My God, I mean, I went into the London Oratory in the 70s and they were very, very strict on time and if you're taking time out or anything like that. They were really strict on that. And I think this father's wrong. I really do. So he's now been ordered to pay, let's see, Mr. Platt has been ordered to return to magistrates court and pay his fine, £60, or face a larger £2,500 fine and a potential drought term. You can't just, you know, what is it that people think they're above the law all the time? Shocking, absolutely shocking. And I do go along with the court's ruling on that myself. I don't know what you think about it. Perhaps you'll put a little message under there. I won't take any more calls now because we're running overtime as usual. I intended to do half an hour today. Darren says, I agree about keeping children in school. I do wish, however, that travel companies would not hike up the prices in summer holidays so many families are unable to go away. Now, that goes, you're absolutely right, Darren. That goes right across the board. Whether you're going on holiday in bloomin' Florida, you look at the air tickets. You look at the price of the air travel if you were going, say, not now because they're on Easter holiday, so they're going to be dearer now. But choose a time when there's no school holidays and then choose a time when there are school holidays, maybe the middle of August, and look at the difference in the plane tickets. It goes from that end right back to where I go on holiday. I go on caravan holidays now all over the UK. And it's the same for me. Now, I'm going on holiday in a couple of weeks' time, right? For 4 nights, okay, it was a Sun voucher But that's neither here nor there. I've been going to four nights in a caravan near my sister, £120. That same holiday in the middle of August is nearly £500. So I know exactly what you mean there, Darren. They hike those prices up, the travel companies. On the other hand, they're going to make their money somewhere. You know, I'm lucky. I can choose. I'm very lucky. I'm freelance. I mean, you can't just keep going on holiday, even if you're freelance, because someone has to love your job. Unless you want to give it away, you know. Someone has to love you. If you like the job that you're doing, you can't just keep going on holiday left, right and centre. You've got to be sensible about it. But I'm lucky that I can choose any time of the year to go away, and the cheapest time, and then I don't, you know, you won't see me go away in August or July. Besides, much that I love children, okay, I don't want to be on a beach surrounded by thousands of, well, I don't like beaches anyway, but I don't want to be out somewhere at some sort of attraction or theme park when there are thousands and thousands of children trying to get on these rides, and you can't get anywhere. You know, I'm doing my head in. So you won't see me on holiday in January, in July or August ever, really, unless I'm just going up to my sister's. I can cope with 6 or 7 children. That's about my limit. When it comes to thousands, how do school teachers do it? Miss, were you a teacher's pet? I bet you were a teacher's pet. Paul says, hi, Chris. Me and Sean are going to make a trip to Central Station to see you before we go off to Las Vegas. Oh, yeah. I've been to Las Vegas, Paul. Fantastic. That's where I saw Barry Manilow in Las Vegas. The great show there at the Paris Theatre. And I also saw, while I was there, Elton John and also Liza Minnelli. I saw all those people in Vegas. I was just lucky they all happened to be there at the same time. You'll love it there. Go to the Grand Canyon. OK, now there are various different trips that you can do in the Grand Canyon. The one I'm recommended to you, you want to do the flying helicopter and boat trip. That's in one day. That's one trip. OK, so you fly to the helicopter place. The helicopter lifts off and takes it. And by the way, if you've never been on a helicopter, they are as smooth as silk. There's none of this. You know, like you get in a plane sometimes with the turbulence. Don't get it in a helicopter. You wouldn't believe how smooth the ride is in a helicopter unless you've been in one. So get then the helicopter land. That goes and flies through all these little crevices and things like that. That lands, and then you get a boat along, I think it's the Colorado River, and it's just so peaceful and lovely. You will love it there, my friend, okay? All right, Paul. Let's have a look there. All right. And one more story there, and then we'll do today's birthdays, boys and girls. I don't know what I'm doing tonight. It's possible that we might do a show tonight as well. Okay, it just depends. Now, this has come from the lovely Wendy, and she sends this in from the Leyland Guardian. Now, Leyland is where Wendy lives, and we used to have British Leyland cars. I found this for you, Wendy. Have a listen to this. Oh, this is fabulous. It's a bit iffy, the tune. Here we go. British Leyland. Lovely tune. I think they start singing in a minute. I hope so, anyway. I'm sure they were singing when I listened to it earlier. British Leyland. British Leyland. Here it comes, I think. I hope so. Here it comes. Leyland cars. I'm sorry, the quality of that is absolutely dire, isn't it? But I had to play that to you. British Leyland cars, wow, that's years old, that is. An old advert from the 1970s. And that was just the music bit, so you'd have someone talking over that. You know, come to British Leyland on Monday, where all prices are 10% off. Oh, talking of 10% off. Oh, God, I've got to tell you, I was out yesterday in in Bentles. We have a Bentles in Bracknell. And we were just walking, literally just walking. I wanted to buy a new duvet. We're just walking through and we have to go past the Ted Baker section. Well, I don't usually look in there. I'm not a mad closer. But oh my God, I saw this grey jacket in there. It is beautiful. The lining is to die for on this jacket. It's a parrot. It's a really brightly coloured lining in this is a Ted Baker. A really nice jacket, grey, I think, and it had like dark grey lapels like that. And I picked it up. And actually, the price of it was about £150 less than what I thought it would be. And it's quite a light summery one. I was very, very tempted yesterday. Or the credit card, it was jumping. The credit card was jumping in my pocket. It really was. So I managed to drag myself away from it. Well, this morning, I've opened my email. How did we get onto this subject? It doesn't matter. This morning, I've opened my email. And guess what? There's a 20% voucher off Ted Baker stuff. So I'm very, very tempted. I might go back and get that today. I might go back and get that. I don't know. If they've got my size, that is. Oh, it's very, very, very tempting. Shall I buy it? Tell me what I should do, boys and girls. I don't know what to do. Because I might have to buy something else soon. A bingo machine. A proper bingo machine with balls. Now, if you're regular to the show, you'll already know a lovely man I used to work for, Justin, is considering doing bingo in his pub in Hemel Hempstead and has asked me if I'd be interested. Yes, I am. I'm interested because it's something that I did years ago, but not with a ball machine. I did it like electronically with you'd push a button and a new number would come up and like that business. But this would be with a ball machine. And it's something new. I like new things to do. I do like new challenges. So this bloke has asked me. Well, last night at the King's Head Theatre Bar, they are also considering now doing a bingo type night. Boozy bingo, where it's like normal bingo, okay? So you'd buy a book of tickets, £5, and then if you get one line, you get a free drink. If you get a full ass, you get a free bottle of wine, something like that. And that would probably go for about 2 hours. So there's a good chance I'm going to have to buy a bingo machine with balls. They ain't cheap, though. They're not cheap. Well, they're cheaper in the States, but you never get the damn thing over here. It costs you a fortune for shipping charges, I would think. Now, years ago, I did have a bingo machine, which I bought for £100. It was an old one from a... Excuse me a minute. It was an old one from a club, but I sold it on because I only had a small car at the time, and I very quickly realised I couldn't move the damn thing around. You needed two people to move it. So you can get other ball ones and they will sit on the table. They're reasonable size and you can see the balls running around. That's how I want to do it. Not with some little button and numbers coming up on the screen. So I might have to buy one of those. So, you know, jacket and bingo machine might be too dear, mightn't it? Oh, God, should I buy the jacket? I like that jacket. If I do, you'll see it on the show pretty quickly, all right? Okay, I think we're gonna have to... I haven't done the story yet, have I? Silly you. This is what Wendy sent in. And this comes from the Leyland Guardian. Agias, they're the insurance people, have released a list of weird and wacky claims that were paid out in 2016. In one case, a herd of cows in North Wales got loose from a farm and gathered in a man's garden, causing £7,500 worth of damage. These are insurance claims that have come through, weird and wacky ones. Another case dealt with by the insurer, bees swarmed into a dining room in Taunton in Somerset with black marks left on the carpet when it was smoked out, costing nearly £200 to rectify. Poor little bees. You just smoke them out. You're not allowed to kill bees, you know. They are protected. One here played out after an 84-year-old man from Oxford put his false teeth on the cooker and they slipped under the metal grill. He then put the cooker on and melted them. the insurance people replaced the dentures, costing £945. Ray Reynolds keeps taking his teeth out while he's at... No, it's not Ray, is it? It's Adam. Adam the plumber keeps taking his teeth out when he's singing on the stage. Here's one. An iPad was left on a chopping board in Rochester during a meal. The sink was later filled with water and the iPad received a soaking along with the dishes. Aren't they waterproof iPads? Or is that some of the iPhones? The Agias retail chief executive says, we've seen some weird and wonderful home insurance claims over the 2006, but we've seen some of the strangest yet last year. So there's some very, very interesting insurance claims there, boys and girls. I hope you're not someone that claims all the time, dear. There are such things as accidents, you know. So next time I'm driving along and I accidentally knock you over, you know, remember, it's just an accident. No need to claim. All right? Okay, let's do today's birthdays and then we'll disappear, gang. Happy birthday this morning to Tommy Durkin. Regular at the Black Cap. My God, ever since I was working there anyway, all those years ago. Happy birthday, Tommy. Lovely to see your little face appearing on there. Happy birthday to Jason at the Royal Vauxhall Tavern. Another place that I worked for a while ago now. 45 years old today. Happy birthday, Jason. Happy birthday to Martin Pugh. Oh, we haven't got many today. We had about 20 birthdays yesterday. And also happy birthday this morning to Aria Ralston. They're all the birthdays today. Let's sing the song. Happy birthday, Tommy, Jason, Martin, and Aria, Era. Happy birthday to you. Now, I think is it Era? E-I-R-A. Do you know, I don't know how to say that name, darling. I'm sorry. Is it Era? E-I-R-A. Is it Era? I hope I've got that right for you, my love. Apologies if I haven't, all right? That's it for the show today, boys and girls. Thank you very much for joining me. Now, I'm actually off tonight. Stuff ready. Yeah, I'm off tonight, so I've got the next three Thursdays off. So I don't know if I've got time, I'll come up and do a late night show today. I don't know what my mate's doing. We might be doing something tonight. I'm not quite sure. I think he might have wanted to see Beauty and the Beast. I can't remember now. But so possibly back tonight. If not, I'll see you very soon on the next show. Shall I get that Ted Baker jacket? I can't decide. Oh, please, I can't decide. Thanks so much for listening. Cheerio now. Have a nice Thursday.